Hello and welcome. I'm King Scuba, and this is my second video in a three-part series for Helicopter 101 Basics. This is going to be parts 3 to 5 of the written guide. And what I'm going to be doing today is just giving you everything I know about how I'm actually performing maneuvers. So I'm going to be trying to tell you step by step how to pull off every single maneuver from just your basic takeoff all the way up to complete auto rotation, anti-torque loss, all that stuff, and how to get out of that stuff. The general idea of this guide is not so much for you to perform everything step by step like this, but it's more to hopefully get something inside your head to go click, and it's like, oh, so that's how that dude did that. And you can start learning how to actually get a little more control over this. Now, ARMA is more arcade-ish than a lot of the hardcore sims. You could do a lot of stuff in ARMA that you can't do elsewhere. You can also be a lot rougher and a lot twitchier, I guess, with your aircrafts compared to others. But the flight mechanics are all still there, so once you learn how to do this game, you can go into more hardcore games if you choose that you like doing the flying more than the running and gunning. Or, you know, things of that nature. The mod that I'm using today is called Hell Heli by Dr. Strange Pete. And what this is, it's auto rotation practice. But what I like to use it is for any kind of helicopter practice. It's a very powerful mod. In any case, the first thing we're going to be doing is just your pre-takeoff checks, things of that nature. Your pre-takeoff checklist is looking around you, seeing what you got. So I'm in a bunker. That means I can't go too high and I can't go off to the sides too far, or I'll crash and burn. When I get out of here with my helicopter, I want to kind of take a quick, I want to have a, you know, general awareness going around me, making sure nobody's going to be passing my way and blowing me up when I come out. I'm alone, so I don't have to worry about that. So I'm going to start my helicopter up. And the next thing you want to do is, after you're sure that the ground is safe, you can proceed that way. And then you want to take a look up, make sure nobody's above you or around you. If you see anybody flying over your head, just wait for them to get out of there. Likewise, don't ever really go near pilots. This is part of courtesy to, you know, your fellow pilots and other people. Give people their space. Don't fly over them. Don't fly too near them. Try to give them a heads up, things of that nature. Now, first we're going to go ahead and just talk about just your basic movements. And you could do this at any altitude. Start learning how your helicopter works. The way your helicopter works really depends on this main rotor that I was just looking at. Basically, if it's pitched forward, you're moving forward. If it's pitched backwards, you're moving backwards. So forth and so forth. This is called your cyclic. Your cyclic controls this general movement right here. It's your W, A, S, and D on your joystick, and it's pushing your W, A, S, D on your keyboard, pushing forward, backward, left, and right with your joystick, and whatever variations that you can come up with. That's your cyclic. Again, if you move forward, if you pitch your joystick forward, you're moving forward. Simple as that. The next thing we have is your collective. Collective is when you're gaining altitude or losing altitude. It's your up and down of your aircraft. This can also be mapped to your throttle. If you're using the throttle, remember in my last video, I said you better map that not to the standard collective, but to the analog collectives. Otherwise, it's either going to be full on, full off. The next thing we have is called pedaling. This is also called yawing. So this is pedaling left or yawing left. And this is pedaling right or yawing right. On the keyboard, this is standard X and C. At least in ARMA 2 configurations and old configurations, I think that the staff at Bohemia actually changed around the keys. So there is, that's your basic 6 ways to maneuver your aircraft. Now the next thing I want to discuss is maximum rates of your acceleration and deceleration. And when I say this, what I mean is there's 2 ways to go about this. The maximum rate that you can accelerate is by pitching forward and holding your upwards collective. If you pitch too far forward, you're going to lose altitude, like I am now. But if you go and you pitch it towards about 20 odd degrees, and you can find that out by looking at your virtual horizon, you'll see the little lines there towards the ground. And you see I'm angled down to either the second or the third one down there. Nope, the first one, so 10 degrees then. However, this might go in increments of 30, so I might be pitched at 30. I'm not positive. I've never really paid attention to that one. But by doing this, you'll gain all the speed that your aircraft or helicopter is capable of. Little Bird's capable of about 250-ish. But if I just kind of stable out and just kind of push forward, you see I'm losing my speed there. Now, likewise, if you hold your downwards collective and you pitch up, you'll begin losing the speed as fast as you possibly can. If you pitch too far up, then you're going to be gaining altitude along with it. So, the best way to go about doing this is actually to pitch your nose forward to gain speed, hold your collective. That's easy enough. You can really control this by just kind of slightly tweaking it by pulling back. That way you're not losing too much altitude. When you're trying to lose all your speed, you want to start at a slow pitch first, or slight angle first, like, halfway in between the top line and the bottom line. So here's horizon. I'm holding my downwards collective. I'm just slowly watching my altitude gauge, try not to gain too much, and try not to lose too much either. As you see, it's just a nice gradual stop all the way down to nothing. And that's your maximum rate of deceleration without gaining altitude. Now, there's also the a few other maneuvers that I'll be discussing later, banking and diving and all that. The next thing I want to discuss is called auto hover. All of you know auto hover. Now know why I hate it. In 99% of the time, auto hover is kind of inappropriate to use. The only time I think auto hover has any use in this game, unless it's going to mess with you severely, is one, when you're picking up a tank or something using a sling rope script and you have to be dead nuts right on it. Usually you can negate that by just going into the best hover that you can and then having the dude drive below you. But it's helpful for that. Two is when you have to go straight down on something, you need to take your time lining up and then dropping straight up and down on it. Again, you can do this. You can negate that by actually learning how to minutely control your aircraft here. And three, when you are in an attack helicopter in a PVE situation, and you're just hovering 2 clicks out of the surface or something like that. Those are about the only times I consider auto hover appropriate. Other than that, you're better off doing what I tell you to do in this tutorial I'm doing. I'm going to give you all the tips you'll need to never use that stupid thing again. Now, the reason why I really hate auto hover is because, say I'm going at a decent speed. Notice my altitude here. I am at a comfortable 30 at the moment. I'm going to engage auto hover. Okay. So I just popped all the way up to almost 100 meters. Oh. Yep, 100 meters. In fact, 101 meters. Mind you, I wasn't holding my downwards collective. I probably would have popped up to 60 instead. 80, then 60. But the fact remains, this can kill you instantly on the battlefield if you're not smart. And also, if you're in an attack helicopter versus players or something, notice how little maneuverability I get out of my helicopter, how long it's taking me to do anything. That can kill you on the battlefield easily because you're just a sitting duck. So, to get your maneuverability back, you either have to go through the button sequence to turn off your auto hover by double tapping one of the slash keys, or you have to go through, scroll down, find auto hover off, try not to turn your engine off, or some other issue, or something useless like turning your lights on or something, and then you have to move. Okay, that takes you at least 1 second to do anything, okay? Auto hover can also kill you, by the way. If you're on auto hover and you start yawing and you have a bank to you, at least this happened in Arma 3. I haven't managed to reproduce it in Arma 3 yet, but again, I don't use auto hover that much. If you're trying to yaw to the side and you have a little sway in your motion, your helicopter will try to overcorrect that and flip you upside down and you go boom on the ground. Quite the comical thing, actually. So it can get you killed too. So the best way is just not to use it, in my opinion, or use it very sparingly. Now, another thing about if you're in a gunship and you're not in auto hover, being in a very unstable hover where you've got some drift to the side, not much, just a little, just kind of like what I'm doing now, will actually make you a much harder target to lead and hit because you're not just sitting there like a twit going, "Oh, hey, I'm an open duck. See if you can snipe me." Okay? Just that little bit of movement is going to keep you alive, whether it's anti-tank or sniper fire. So, just a thought for you. Now then, what I'm going to go ahead and discuss now is just your basic maneuvers. I'm going to be talking about takeoff, cruising, banking, and hovering. After that, we're going to move into several different landings. Oh, my tip to you on how to approach your landings. Then we're going to go into NOE flight, orbits, funnel maneuvers. Finally, wrapping up with anti-torque loss and auto rotation. That is the full agenda on this. So, for takeoff, you have two main ways to take off, but I also include a third one. For takeoff in a real game, you actually need to follow a chart that's also used in auto rotation called the Dead Man's Curve, or it was the airspeed ratio chart or something similar like that. And what this tells you is how fast you should be going in relation to your altitude. So if something messes up, you can still save yourself. So if you're going 200 kilometers an hour, 10 meters off the ground, and you lose your engine, you're not going to be a happy camper and you're going to die. Likewise, if you're going 10 kilometers an hour and you're 300 meters up in the air, you're going to die. Things of that nature. So, or not 300, you're 150 up and you're going 10 meters, you're gonna die because you fall too fast. Okay, it's just things of that nature. That's what the Dead Man's Curve entails. So take a look at that. It's pretty reliable. So the first thing you want to do on takeoff is figure out which style you're going to be taking off with. The one that you are probably most familiar with is actually called the helicopter style takeoff. And the helicopter style takeoff just involves going straight up on your cyclic, obviously after doing your checks for anybody around, and then go, turning in the direction you want to go and starting to move in that direction. This is just your basic style helicopter takeoff. This is best used when you're in congested spots. For example, if I was to land right in here, just this general area, I couldn't do an airplane style takeoff, which is what I'm about to show you. I'd be much better served by going forward and then taking off. The next style takeoff, you're probably going to be using this in armor more for, probably more for more formal situations, or you just might be more comfortable doing this. In real life, you actually want, or in harder simulators, you want to be doing this style of takeoff is most more often than not, because if something goes wrong in your engine or something, or you didn't start it up just right, and you all of a sudden lose all your power, you're going to be able to save yourself and your aircraft by performing your takeoff this way. This simply involves going up in the air a few meters and then pitching forward and gaining speed. After you gain about 100 odd speed, you start going ahead and lifting off. This follows the dead man's curve chart. That way, for safe operation of flight. Again, this is what real life pilots do and all that. In case something goes foobar, you can still save yourself. Now then, the next style takeoff I'm going to tell you about is called the reverse style takeoff. And reverse style is actually more of a kind of a airplane style takeoff, but also a helicopter style takeoff. Now what you do, you want to have a full understanding of what's behind you. And then you simply lift off, you pitch back. And here's the key. When you start gaining speed, you want to kind of level out and begin yawing and then pitch forward again. This allows for very speedy takeoffs, as well as a little bit of showboating, really. You can use this when taking off from a mountain, things of that nature, or if you need to amp spray in the opposite direction immediately. One note I figure I should tell you is if I begin going backwards too fast, I'm not holding any key right now, my helicopter will turn in the direction of travel at about 150 or 180 speed. And I have no control over that at all. So, you can choose to either let the helicopter do that for you, or you can do it yourself. Like I said, if I were you, I would, if I begin yawing to the side, I would start leveling out a little bit, because if you are in too deep of a pitch when your helicopter does a full 180 spin, what's going to happen is you're probably going to slap the ground and go crash and boom. It's lovely fireworks, but I don't like turning into fireworks. All right, so the next thing I want to talk about is cruising. Everybody cruises, whether you think you are or not. Cruising is simply going in one direction at your top speed and just kind of going from point A to B. Simple as that. When you're in cruising, that's the time you can safely open up your map. Make sure that you're looking well far ahead of you. That way, when you open your map, nothing's going to happen. Doing this over open water is actually one of the best places to do this. Or when you are high enough over the mountain or far enough away from the mountain that you know you're not going to slam into it or anything. The next thing I want to talk to you is how you would control turns. At lower speeds, you can actually yaw turn, kind of like what I'm doing right now. It does take a while to do. As you see, I'm just kind of losing my speed. And then just kind of turning. That's one way you can turn. It gains you a little bit of side slip, a little bit of and just kind of an overall long turn. So you can't control it with your pedals. The next thing that you probably have already figured out is called banking. Now, a banking maneuver is when you roll your side, when you roll your helicopter off to the side and begin turning like that, just like this. As you see, I've got a nice slow bank. I'm not holding anything. Now I'm going to use my cyclic and pull backwards. And as you see, all of a sudden my turn starts getting sharper and sharper and sharper. All the way into this. And I'm still holding some speed. So the first way you control your banking maneuver is with your cyclic. The next way you can control your banking, or actually rather, the steeper, the harder your pitch is, that's one way to actually control your altitude, as well as how hard you're going to be, banking. If you go and roll off to a 90 degree angle, or roughly in that general area while you have some speed, as you see, I'm not really losing any altitude. Actually, I'm gaining a little bit of altitude here. But I'm also maintaining my speed, and I'm able to execute a very, very sharp turn. If I go past the 90, I'll actually begin losing some altitude. And while I'm holding my downwards collective, as well as my backward cyclic, and if I'm kind of at a slighter angle, you'll see that I'm actually losing speed but gaining a little bit of altitude. The next way that you can control this is by using your collective, obviously. So if I'm over here at a 90 degree angle and I hold my upwards collective, I'm gaining some altitude here. But if I drop my collective, I'm starting to slow down and go down a little bit on my and start going down a little bit in air and speed. So that's another way you can control your maneuver. One of the most important ways to control your banking is actually by using your nose. And to use your nose, you want to be paying attention to your virtual horizon. As you see, if I do this and I kind of keep my nose I kind of watch and I keep my nose kind of towards the air, I will be gaining some altitude. If I keep it really close to the horizon, I won't be gaining much altitude, I won't be losing altitude, and I'll be gaining just a hair bit of speed as well. Or in worst case scenario, I'll be keeping the main speed. However, if I point it up towards the air, I'm going to lose all my speed and gain altitude. Just like that. And if I begin one of these and I keep the nose towards the ground when I'm doing this, I'm going to be losing some altitude, but gaining a lot of speed. Just like that. So your nose is very important when banking. And finally, you can control this the banking maneuver by using your pedals. Now, you would think that this wouldn't be too important, but by pedaling to the side when you're in these steep rolls in your helicopter, as you see, this is it's actually giving me quite a bit of extra minute control, especially at the lower speeds. So, for example, I'm going to be doing a 180 stop. So I'm going to roll, I'm going to pull back on my collective, and I'm also going to twist into the spin. As you see, that pretty much brought me to a dead stop right over where I wanted it. And I could come into a very fast hover from that area. And then at lower speeds, yawing works up towards about 100 and above. it starts being it's you just don't get a lot of you don't get a lot of sway out of it, but you do get some. So it is a force on your helicopter to know about, depending on what you want to do. It's just an extra bit of control over your helicopter. Learn what your pedals are doing to your helicopter. You're going to be a much better pilot for it. Start running out of a little gas, so I'm going to demonstrate something really fun about Hell Heli here. I can hit repair, and I'm at full gas again. Everything's fixed. I'm full gassed. I'm going again. Now, finally, something about coming into a hover. When you go into a hover, it's actually one of the most important things that you should learn as a helicopter pilot. A good hover is in between negative 1 and 1 kilometer an hour with a very, very little side drift. The ideal hover is no forward movement, no sideward movement. And you can control this by watching your virtual horizon and just kind of slightly tapping your directional keys. Just like I'm doing here. See, I'm in a pretty decent hover, and I'm just kind of just very slightly tapping on my keyboard keys just to stop me moving in these directions that I don't want to go. All while kind of paying attention to my virtual horizon, along with my airspeed gauge, or rather my airspeed HUD and all that stuff. I'm being a little over-exaggerated here, but you're getting the point here. And a good hover allows you to do many things. So, it is something that you should work to perfect. It's really hard in games like this because you're not actually in the pilot seat. So, you're not feeling the momentum shifting and learning to fine-tune it. All you have is real visual aids. Now, finally, I'm going to start going into, or rather, again, it's tap, tap, tap for hovering. For a lot of your minute and for a lot of your last moment movements, you always want to be tapping on your keys, not holding. If you're holding a key, you're not as controlled as a slight tap. We're going to go ahead and start going to do the various landings. The first thing you want to do whenever you land is select your landing zone. After that, you want to select the way you're going to approach. And finally, when you go in for the approach, you are kind of slowing down. You're in a very nice, comfortable, steady space, and then you're landing. Now, my three tips for you on landing is, again, your approach to the landing zone. After that, you want to enter kind of a I guess a balance state would be a good word for it. And what this means is that you're in between your cruising and your landing. So you're going at a controlled speed in between 80 kilometers and 100 or so, where you can quickly shift in between the two states, stay alive, and control high maneuverability. This is your balance state, and this is what I'm doing right now. As you see, I can quickly control my movement. I can quickly shift into higher speeds, just like that, or I can immediately stop on a dime. Just quick example for you. Okay, so after your initial approach, you slow down into the balance state. When you're finally getting towards the actual place that you want to land, say I want to land in front of this bunker, so I'm going to slow down a little bit. I'm going to begin kind of a yaw without hurting my helicopter. And then I'm going to stop and touch down. Again, you can be very rough with your aircraft in this game. last one, I kind of forgot that I had my finger on my downward collective. So, I was wondering why I was going down. And again, you're just entering your final stage of landing and then just touching down. Very fast, very efficient, keeps you moving. If you're going 90, if you're going in between 80 and 100 kilometers an hour, you'll find that you're a very hard target to hit unless you're literally flying straight into the enemy's face where he has a clear shot of you. If he's off from the side, you're very hard to hit. Heck, just going 30 kilometers an hour makes you a very hard target to hit, except for a very seasoned sniper or marksman. So, that is my 3 points. Your approach, go into your balance state, and finally land. And you could control your land by utilizing a flare, dropping straight down if you have large enough wheels to accommodate you, rolling out, so on and so forth. So, I'm going to explain two approaches for you first, and then I'll explain just a couple different ways you can make final contact with the ground. The first way that you can approach something is with an airplane-style landing. Airplane-style landings are probably what you want to be doing most of the time. It's where you line up way far back. I'm lining myself up with the radio tower down at the end of the highway down there. So you line yourself up way far back. You begin transitioning. That way you're slowing down well enough to get to it. And then you're going to be approaching it just like this. Drop your speed and do your final maneuver, whatever it is. And then just touch down. That is an airplane style landing. The next style of landing is where you actually just go straight on down. This is a helicopter style landing. It's where I'm just going straight up and down for my final landing. You'll do this in tight spaces, places where you don't have a full-on line of view on where you're landing. For example, in between this wall and this shed here. You just kind of drop down nice and steady and go straight up and down. It's something that only a helicopter can do, hence why it's called a helicopter-style landing. So, next I'm going to discuss a rollout landing to you. There's a high-speed and a low-speed rollout landing. With helicopters such as the Little Bird here, you need to be at a lower speed to achieve this. So I'm going to be doing a rollout landing kind of on the end of this runway. And all I'm going to be doing, going into my balance state, kind of keeping a high speed. Then I'm going to drop down to about 50 kilometers an hour just to be safe. And I'm literally just going to slam down on the ground. I skid out a little bit. Nobody on the helicopter is hurt. My helicopter is still in complete flying condition, and it's good to go. This will probably be the best way for you to begin learning how to fly and land your helicopter. And it's very useful to use with an airplane style landing. The next way you can make contact is by utilizing a flare maneuver. And a flare maneuver is when you pitch your aircraft in the opposite direction of travel and you stop your speed in one instant or as fast as you possibly can. When you're slowing down slowly, kind of like this, this is actually a bleed flare, what I like to call it. I'm just slowly bleeding off my speed by utilizing a flare. a slow flare, not instantaneous. I'm going to be using a front flare right here. As you see, it's just a hard pitch. I'm tapping on my downwards collective and releasing it. I only tapped it twice at the very start, just so I wasn't gaining altitude. I was keeping myself low to the ground. If you hold your downwards collective, what happens after flare is you actually have a natural drop down. And another thing about that is actually when you're flying your helicopter, you actually... Well, watch my instantaneous vertical speed. You see how it takes a while to build up, and then it takes a while to drop back down? The same thing applies for going downwards. It takes a while for your engine to rev back up in order for you to stop doing what you're doing. And you really don't have much control over this, unfortunately. You just gotta learn what it is. When you're first learning how to land and you don't want to damage your helicopter, the maximum instantaneous vertical speed I would recommend you doing is in between 5 and 8. So, that's your maximum speed you want to be doing when you're within like 10 meters of the ground. You just kind of keep it at... You see what I did? There's no damage to your helicopter. And once you get that, once you learn to read your dial, you'll begin getting your visual cues. That way, you're just paying attention to what's going on around you and how fast the ground's coming up to meet you. And then you won't have to rely on that gauge anymore. You just know it by feel. The next style of flare I'm going to show you is called a side flare. A side flare is really useful if you have to come onto the side of a mountain. For me, I just kind of prefer to do it. It's also useful if you have to land right on the next to something. You yaw to the side, and then you add in some... you roll into the opposite direction of travel. Again, you're making your blade work for you. I'll show you this again. This does take a while to set up. So as you see, I'm just kind of slowly turning into it, so I'm at about 90 degree angle. Then I'm rolling in the opposite direction of travel. I'm recovering myself, and then I'm dropping down. So again, it's useful for if you have to land in the middle of something, two tight spaces, and you don't want to take a hook pattern into it. Just like what I'm doing here. It's useful if you're trying to land on the side of a road, on a mountain. You can keep a full visual of what you're doing, like what I'm doing here, and then you can flare out and you are dead nuts on your target. With a front flare landing, you kind of lose sight of the ground unless you have something like track IR. I'll demonstrate that right now. So you see I'm at the ground and I'm going to do a side flare. See, I'm kind of losing sight and I just actually slapped down, which is also a bit of an issue there too. That's one thing you want to be cautious of when you're doing this. You want to be careful on your collective, and you want to be high enough off the ground to be able to actually execute it. See, this is actually how you need to be doing a front flare landing. You need to be looking out the side and using visual cues like that. And you could easily do this with just your mouse and keyboard when you're using your mouse for free look. Personally, I switch between my mouse and my keyboard because I don't have I don't have track IR and I don't have a second-hand throttle such as the Cytec X54 or 45, whatever it is, or the 65. The next style of flare that I'm going to show you is called a reverse flare. You're probably not going to be using this too much. It's quite a bit of a hassle to use. But the physics are still there. I'm going to be doing a complete yaw at 100 degrees or 180 degrees. So now, as you see, I'm going backwards in my momentum. I'm going to pitch forward. And that's going to stop my momentum, and I'm going to drop down. So you saw how long that took to actually execute it. But as you see, it can be useful in some situations. For example, if I need to land, if I'm not sure what's going on the opposite side of this building, I'll kind of do this maneuver. As you see, I'm still kind of got, I've got my 180 going on, and I can take a quick peek and then drop down. Again, I'm showing you a long out, drawn out process of this. That way the way these are working are actually trying to click in your mind for you. Now what I'll use this particular style of flare for is if I need to see the opposite side of something before I land. If I'm landing on the, if I have to land, say, on the back side of a mountain of my travel, I'll use a reverse flare and add some forward momentum to it, so on and so forth. Now the next style of landing I want to show you is actually a throwback to your banking. I'm sure this might have already hit in your head, but you can use this maneuver to land very fast, very tight. This is also called a U landing, a 180 landing, so forth and so on. I call it a banking landing because I'm banking to initiate it. And again, all you do, you roll hard, you pull back on your stick, and you're pedaling into the actual, you're pedaling into the turn. That'll bring you out to a hover, and then you just touch down light as you can be. I don't usually use a lot of collective on it, because I find that if I over collective, then I'm going to slam down on the ground really hard. And you saw how far from the ground I did when I did that. I was only about 10 meters up off the ground. And again, you want to kind of keep your nose, you want to keep your nose more towards the air when you're doing that. And what's happening when you're adding in some pedal to that is you're actually creating kind of a natural side flare. So it's very handy for you too. And it can be done in both directions, whatever you feel is more comfortable for you. I'm tapping on my downwards collective now. And I'm coming down into it. Another note about flaring is you want to be very careful about over flaring. For example, if I'm in a if I'm going to execute a front flare here, I'm going to over flare this. Okay, so one, I hit the ground, which is definitely no bueno. It's too low to the ground. Larger aircrafts, you have to remember, have to also be higher up off the ground. So I'm going to overflare this real quick. Now I'm going to try recovering. Oops. And as you see, now I'm moving backwards. And this can be a little dangerous because you might have to be in a very precise spot to drop down. And if you have something behind you, you just took out your aircraft. Likewise, if you overflare like I did at the start, you'll tail whip the ground. So you need to be careful about your altitude as well as your as well as just how long you're actually flaring. When you're going in for a landing, by the way, you don't want to have too much sidewards movement in your landing. You can just accomplish this by simply by approaching it like I've taught you. Keep yourself in a balanced state until the very last moment. Then you're going to bleed off all your speed and touch down. As you see, I get very little sidewards movement with that. What most people have issues with, I personally believe, is they're trying to come to a complete hover like this. And as you see, then I'm going to try landing up and I'm starting to move in directions I don't want to be going into because one, I'm either holding my control down instead of tapping it, or two, I accidentally went over too far with my movement, and then I'm going in the opposite direction of travel that I'd want to be going into. So remember, keep some speed up on your approach. Don't go into a hover until the last minute where you have to, and always tap, tap, tap. Tap them keys. Or be very light and feather your joystick. The next style of landing I'm going to be talking about is called a pinnacle landing. I'm not going to show this, I'm just going to tell you about it. A pinnacle landing is when you land on any elevated surface. And why this matters, it doesn't matter in ARMA, but I'm going to tell you about it anyways. At higher elevations, you have higher winds because there's not as much blocking it. It's not that big of a deal when you're down towards the ground and you have things, blocking your wind. But if I try landing on top of this hill here, I might end up getting a crosswind that tries shoving me into the mountain, or I might get a headwind that's trying to push me back, or a tailwind that's pushing me forward, giving me some little extra speed. So you need to be cautious when you're landing up high in games with actual wind currents, such as Take-On Helicopters and DCS, and also Microsoft Flight. The next style of landing is called a congested landing. And a congested landing is any time that you have multiple objects that can screw your aircraft up royally, such as a house, a wall, a tree, a light pole, so on and so forth, any physical object. If it's not flat and clean, it's a congested landing. So a great example of congested landing is actually this road here, or in between this house in the back. This is a congested landing right here. Just enter these landings from the balance state. Pick a good spot to keep your eye on. And then drop down on the ground. I actually chose this little fence post right here for my waypoint, that little wood one, because I knew that I had enough visual, I knew I had enough space in the back to drop myself down, and then I oriented myself so I wasn't going to be hitting this tree here. And what actually just happened was I entered what's called a light landing. So I thought I was all the way on the ground, but what actually happened was I lifted off a little bit and I started moving to the side. So when you actually land, one thing you want to do is hold your downwards collective for that extra second when you land, and that's going to put you into a hard landing where you're not going to be picked up and, moving. So that is something to also be aware of when you're flying. Always hold the downwards collective after you land. That way you're not picking up when you're not expecting it and slamming into people, vehicles, walls, mountains, and killing your helicopter and all aboard. The next style of landing I'm going to be talking about is called a slope landing. And this happens anytime the ground isn't relatively flat. For example, mountains. Mountains are slope landings. Now, how I like to approach these is with an airplane style landing. I'm setting myself up quite a far bit far back, and I'm picking my last spot at kind of like near the last second. That way, I make sure there's no trees or rocks in the way. You want to keep some forward momentum when you're landing on these things. I'm going to land right in this little hill over here. You keep some forward momentum, you enter your balance state. Then you just start bleeding off down to about 40-ish. And you really don't even have to have any forward momentum on this. You just kind of, hell, I'm not even holding the downwards collective. I'm just letting the hill meet me and then holding. See, you don't even have to apply downwards collective if you're at the right altitude. Just drop your speed so you can land safely on it. And another thing, you always want to be keeping your nose pointing towards the summit of that mountain. If you don't, and you try and landing on it, and you try landing on it like this right here, where your nose is following the mountain range instead of the peak, what could happen is you drop down, especially in larger helicopters, and you roll over. So being on this kind of hill is very dangerous. So always keep your nose pointing towards the summit of that hill, mountain, or whatever you're trying to land on. This will keep your helicopter straight up at all times. Another thing about landing is, again, always keep forward momentum. If you don't have any forward momentum and you try dropping down on a slope, what could happen, this slope's too shallow for it. I'm going to move over real quick. What could happen is, say I'm going to try dropping on this slope here. I'm coming in from a hover. And I moved back a little bit on this one. Again, it's kind of a shallow slope. If you try landing on a steep slope without any forward momentum, your helicopter, when you touch down, could begin sliding back really fast on you. And this is very dangerous because you could hit a tree or something similar. So keep your forward momentum, keep your nose towards the summit, let the mountain meet you. Just like what I just did. I didn't use any collective there. I just angled my nose up a little bit, let the mountain meet me. When you take off from a slope, as you see, I actually added a little forward momentum or cyclic to that. But when you take off from a slope, you will be going backwards, pretty much regardless of what you're doing. So you can either take advantage of it, or you can quickly save yourself from it. So I'm going to go ahead and take off without any cyclic. In fact, I'm going to add some reverse cyclic, and this is a reverse style takeoff. Just like this. I'm beginning fast, then I'm spinning into the direction of travel I want to go into. And there you have a perfect reverse style takeoff. The next thing you can do when you're landing on a summit is you can go ahead and add a you can add some forward momentum to you can actually go ahead and just pitch forward and go into a helicopter style takeoff instead, like this right here. See, I'm trying to cut down my reverse movement as much as I can. That way I don't hit something behind me, such as a tree, a rock formation, or another wall. So, you need to be careful when you're doing that. The next thing I'm going to talk to you about is actually hover inserts. Or my bad, I actually need to talk to you about if your helicopter goes down on the side of a hill, you need to be careful when you're taking off. So you what you want to do if your helicopter has come to a complete stop on the hill and you're just firing it up, say you got taken out by a missile, or you had to leave it there for a second. So you're all the way down at nothing. I'm gonna engine off here and show you. You want to be very careful when you're doing this because on steeper hills especially, if you were to try leaving your helicopter off and then you try starting it up again and you just try taking off like normal, what's gonna end up happening is you're going to begin generating just enough lift to coming into a light landing. And what's going to happen then is you're going to start sliding down that mountain. So you want to watch this gauge on the bottom left in the little bird. Wait for it to get to about 70 or so. And that's giving you enough RPMs in your engines and motor to pick up straight off the ground. Don't ever hold. When you're actually on a steeper slope, you want to hold your downwards collective. That way you're cutting as much lift as you possibly can. That way you don't go into a light landing. You're trying to stay sucked on that ground until you can make a full lift off. So what I'm going to talk about now is a hover insert and a hover extract. And just like the name implies, it's coming in and not making contact with the ground to pick up troops. So the best example I have of this right now is, say I want to pick up a troop off the side of this hill. I'm just going to land on it like this. I'm not going to land at all. I'm just coming into a hover and maintaining this hover. That way the troops can look at my helicopter and get in really fast. Okay? This is a hover insert, hover extract. I'm just staying low to the ground, letting the guys jump out or jump in. It is literally as simple as that. You can use this for very fast inserts by coming into the ground and dropping your speed. Instead of making full contact with the ground, you can rely on the squad leader in your aircraft to give the initiative to get the hell out. Such as right here. He would tell his troops to jump out, and I'm off. You see how fast that is? It takes coordination to do that. If you're going too fast or you're too high, then you're going to injure the troop. Then you're going to injure yourself by jumping out. And there's also, when you're doing it over water, it's called a helocast or a helo extract from or helo water extract rather. And again, you're just flying over the water, you're coming into a hover. And you want to do this about in between zero, in between 1 and 10 meters off the ground with very little momentum, and they can jump off safely from your helicopter into the water. Okay, now to pick them up, you just come into a hover, drop down to pretty much 0 meters on top of the water here, drop your momentum as but drop all your speed, and just let them get in like this. Okay? And that's how you can extract from the water. For a water approach, all you got to do is flying over water is very, very easy. Very, very easy. It doesn't come up, it doesn't go down. So all you got to do is learn how to do your maximum rates of acceleration and deceleration correctly. And look, simple as that. The next thing I'm going to talk to you about is are just a couple maneuvers real quick, and that's just a dive and a climb. I was talking about this earlier with the maximum rates of acceleration and deceleration. So if I want to climb as fast as I can, I'm going to hold my upwards collective and I'm going to pull back on the stick. This gives me the maximum I can possibly get speed-wise or altitude-wise immediately. The sharper back I pull while I'm holding my upwards collective, I'm going to be gaining that speed. The reverse one, with a dive, to go down as fast as you possibly can, you just dive really fast, switch into your upwards collective, and then move forward from there. One thing you might want to do is just hold upwards collective and do a really steep dive, because the dive will actually give you a lot of the dive's going to get you a lot of speed, as you see here. A lot of speed, but if you're holding your downwards collective while you go into a dive, remember, it takes a few seconds for it to transfer from downwards momentum to upwards momentum for the cyclic there, or sorry, collective. So you could try switching it in between the two too late, and you're gonna hit the ground and go boom. The next thing I'm gonna be talking about is called NOE flight. NOE flight is any flight path that takes you within 35 meters of the ground and under. So right now I'm going to be flying an NOE path just like this. As you see, I'm staying fairly low to the ground, keeping my speed up. What this does, one, it avoids SAM, it avoids radar, and it keeps you hidden. That way you're keeping the enemy guessing as much as they can as to where your actual position is. Okay? So it's a very good idea to always be in NOE flight. The next thing about NOE flight that's really nice is it makes it a lot easier on you to auto-rotate. Because you're close enough to the ground where you're giving yourself a lot of leeway to drop onto the ground. If you're too close to the ground, of course, that makes it a little dangerous. So if you stay in between 15 and 35 meters to the ground, you will have a much easier time actually saving your aircraft in an emergency situation. Just use your sense, start high. Start going lower when you get more comfortable with it. And you also want to be trying to use the ridges and the valleys as much as you can. Obviously, an NOE flight is pretty stupid if you're trying to make this by following the roads on top of a mountain. You're not hidden, you're on the radars, and the people are seeing you and know exactly where you are. So use these hills as your cover. Okay. See, even this is a much smarter NOE flight than what I was doing up there. The next thing I'm going to be talking to you about is called an orbit. This is also known as flying a holding pattern. You can use this for intel gathering. Such as you're just flying around trying to tell everybody what's actually going on. So you can be flying around like this in a holding pattern and just giving intel to the ground troops. Helicopters are not just for shooting and getting troops to A and B. You can use them tactically and tell people what's going on the floor. Mind you, it takes a lot of practice to be able to even see anything because you have to be constantly moving, constantly vigilant, and looking for things. And it gets very hard to do when you're in a helicopter because people don't want to be actually seeing. They don't want to be seen by the helicopter that might have a minigun on it. Not the smartest thing to do. All right. The next nice thing about a holding pattern, and again, you saw a holding pattern, is just be circling a wide area. You can have a short holding pattern or you can have a wide holding pattern. A short holding pattern is basically what I'm doing. I'm flying over a town. But if I want to have a large holding pattern, I'm gonna get like 2 clicks out of that town and just kind of circle. And if I'm doing this, I'm probably medevac or some kind of fast extract because you know that the town is going to be done shortly, so you're just kind of holding around it, lingering. And this cuts your travel time. Okay, say I just got called in for a medevac in the center of the town. Okay, instead of flying from the base, okay, I'm already here. Hence why it's a good thing to do. Not to mention it gives the pilot something to do instead of sitting on the ground with their thumb up their butt going, "Oh, duh, I so bored." The next maneuver I'm going to be showing you is called a funnel maneuver. And again, what this is actually good for is always keeping your eye on a target. It's especially useful in a gunship. There's two ways you can initiate a funnel maneuver. You could come at it from a dead stop like this. This is probably what you want to be learning initially. As you see, you come from a dead stop and you're going to roll into this. Into the direction you want the funnel to be going into. Start high when you're learning your funnel maneuver. Okay, you're then going to begin pedaling and nosing down. Okay, so now I'm just using my roll to gain speed. I'm kind of pulling back into my roll and I'm keeping my nose down. while I've always got my pedal in the opposite direction of my circle. So I'm banking right, but I'm holding my yaw left as hard as I possibly can, okay? But I'm also slightly feathering on the yaw every now and again if I have to, but most of the time it's just full on. Then you can also control this by going in and adding in some collective. Again, the tighter your funnel's going to be, the less momentum you're going to have on your roll. See, I'm actually just kind of going around this house now, trying to keep it a nice steady circle. That way, I'm not getting hit by enemies. Funnel maneuvers are a pain in the butt to hit, so it keeps you very safe, believe it or not, when you're doing a funnel maneuver. As you see, I've got this whole house. Nobody's getting out of that house without me knowing about it. So I'm keeping enemies pinned in there if they're actual players. And they're just trying to take pot shots at me. Okay? Or if I'm in an attack helicopter, that house is already leveled. Or it might even be a tank, and I'm just attacking this tank, and it's, again, I'm keeping my cursor on it pretty much the entire time, and it's done. I'll show you that right now. Just gonna switch out into. I'm gonna grab a Kajman because I like those better. And I'm going to take manual fire. So the next way you can insert into a funnel maneuver, you drop your speed to about 100 and then you yaw all the way to the side, kind of like what I'm doing here. Then you roll into it really quickly and you put your nose down. See, now I'm in a funnel maneuver around this little house here, but I've got too much side slip to hold it, so I have to account for that. As you see, I've got this house full of my sights. Unfortunately, crosshairs aren't working correctly on this. But as you see, I've got a full lock on what I'm doing. I'm keeping myself on target and so on and so forth. When you stop a funnel maneuver, all you really have to do is let go of your opposite direction pedal or yaw, and then you can completely go off flying in the direction you were going, and you'll be going out of your funnel maneuver at like 200 odd kilometers an hour. And you, as a final note on a funnel maneuver, you can actually be going extremely fast over a very wide range. So I'm going to do a funnel maneuver around this whole city here pretty much real quick, just to give you an idea. I'm actually kind of feathering lightly on my I'm feathering very lightly on my pedal instead of holding it hard. And I'm using my nose and my roll to just keep myself on target of that city. So this is dang near a. This is almost like a holding pattern, really. As you see. And I'm going very fast in this funnel maneuver while keeping my eye on this city. And when I want to leave it, I just let go of my stick, pretty much. And you see, I was going 200 kilometers an hour doing that. And I just scraped the ground. Like a boss. The final thing I'm going to be talking to you, just showing you real quick, is an airplane style landing with a larger aircraft. I could do it in the Cosman, but I prefer to do it in the Mohawk. It's just a lot easier. So remember I was talking about a rollout airplane style landing. If you have a big wheel, you can go really fast. with the Mohawk, you can actually make it go as fast as you possibly want it to go. And it's very easy to do. So I'm just going to go ahead and line up with my runway here on my final approach. Okay, so you line up with your runway, doesn't matter how fast you're going. Yes, you start coming in low to the ground like this, even out on your virtual horizon. And then literally just drop down, hold your downwards collective. You can kind of control the way you're going with some pedaling. And you come to a full stop like that, with no damage. Okay, so that was the full rollout landing I was talking about. You can only really do that at the moment in the Cosman and the Mohawk here. Gonna switch back to my Hummingbird now. Now what I'm gonna go ahead and display to you is anti-torque loss and how to get out of it. So let's say I'm going to go ahead and come into a rough hover here. Actually, I'm going to pick up speed and show you. Say I'm going at speed and I lose my anti-torque loss. The first thing you're going to hear is a lot of beeping telling you something just hit you. So I'm going to go to tail rotor failure. You see I actually pitched off to the side there a little bit. So that's the first indication that you lose your tail rotor. I'll show that again to you. You see how I just pit? You see how I'm yawing off to the right there? In every helicopter, as far as I'm aware, you will always be turning off to the right side during an auto hover, or sorry, a tail rotor loss. So keep that in mind. Okay, so now I'm going to come down all the way down to my speed. As you see, I'm now spinning because I have no anti-torque correcting my main rotor. So I'm just spinning here with no pedal control. Now, if I increase my collective, I'm actually starting to spin a lot faster. Likewise, if I lower my collective as far as I can, I almost come to a complete stop. Again, I have no tail rotor though, so I can't pedal at all. So, how you want to fix this is you want to decide in a direction of travel. I'm going to go ahead and start going towards the airbase. So I'm going to pitch forward. I'm going to hold my upwards collective. I'm going to pitch back when I'm about 180 degrees to that. And I'm going to pitch forward again. Easy money. Now I'm going in the right direction of travel. Now, if you mess up and you end up going sideways, just literally turn your cyclic in the direction. So, say I'm going off to the left. I'm flying left. So, all of a sudden, my left would become nose down, my right would become nose up. And you fly just like normal. Now, for landing this, what I would recommend you doing is actually approach it like a banking landing, because you are going to be turning in that direction anyway, so it's going to feel very normal for you, actually. So I'll go ahead and show that. I'm going to go ahead and drop my speed and begin a bank, just like this. I'm holding my downwards collective, letting the helicopter come into this turn. And I'm just tapping my downwards collective. That way, not much is actually going to happen. Just tapping down. And I've safely set myself on the floor. So, you can actually get quite a good deal of, maneuverability with this by making sure that you're shifting on your between your upwards and balanced and your downwards collective. As you see, I'm able to control my movement fact, I'll land it right in front of that hangar there just to show you. So, takes a bit of practice to be able to do this kind of stuff. And just like that, I managed to do it. I slammed down a little too hard, though, so I actually lost my stuff. Now, again, you want to do that banking maneuver because you're making that tail rotor work for you, and it's actually becoming just like a 180 for you instead. I'll demonstrate that again real quick. Go into my tail rotor here. I'm just going to turn around, that way I can begin this maneuver down the runway. It just kind of flies like an airplane when you have no tail rotor. Just as simple as that. Okay. And you see, it's basically like coming straight down into a normal hover when I'm dropping it. When you lose your tail rotor and you're in a combat zone and you have no way of getting back out, don't worry about damaging your aircraft. Just land safely, that way your troops can get out. And again, landing without a tail rotor is very easy if you're doing what I'm telling you to do. Next thing I'm going to show you is how to do an auto rotation. Auto rotation is how you land your aircraft with no engine, and you're just losing your rotors slowly. Okay? You lose power, you lose your engine, this is how you fix it. So I'm going to go ahead and show you engine failure here. The first thing you want to do is you want to start cutting your speed and holding your downwards collective. You don't have long to do this. I'm slowly dropping down, or I'm slowly losing all my speed. And you just want to kind of come into this however is most convenient for you. Touchdown. And when you're down towards the ground, you want to hold your upwards collective again. Okay? When you're close to the ground, I repeat, hold your upwards collective. This is going to give you kind of a pillow effect on the ground, and then you can touch down nice and soft instead of slamming down, okay? Go ahead and gain some momentum here, and I'll show you this again. You don't have much time to focus on this. It's just going to happen. Okay, so this time I'm going to try using this hill right here as a as my pillow instead. I'm going to land on it like a slope landing. Just drop down, and here we go. Nice and soft. However, I did end up, since I bounced off, I ended up losing it and it's sliding on me. But everybody's safe, nobody's damaged. We can get out, either fix the helicopter or blow it up and go on with it. Now, what's really cool about this here is I can enable random. So I have random failure enabled, and I could go into control panel and I can set the times for these. Random is going to set it so I can lose either my main rotor or my anti-torque or my engine as well. So I'm going to go ahead and show you what to do if you lose your tail rotor as well. It's just like landing. Literally, it's just like landing without a with no tail rotor. You just got to do it a lot quicker. And again, you always want to be trying to hold on and use a. You want to be going at this while always having an NOE. That's why I tell you it's a very smart idea to have your NOE path set at all times. Allows you to quickly and safely exit the aircraft in case something happens. Starting to wonder if the script is broken. I haven't lost my engine yet. I might have also just lost my anti-torque at one point or another. Try not to hit the ground. Okay, I don't know what's going on with the random here. I might not have it set up correctly.